There's a team introduction first. And I work with a fantastic dynamic team behind this successful program. And here is an introduction. He's our director at the organization that runs the YES program in Pakistan. It's Society for International Education. Next slide. Is Irfan, and he actually works directly with me, helping me with the mostly with parents' issues and paperwork and documentation. And Hassan Saeed is an alumni himself. From 2008 and 2009, I guess. And he's our program officer and runs the alumni and the other youth program. And Umair is based in the northern part of Hassan is based in northern Pakistan. And Umair, who is also an alumni of YES program, alumni is from 2008, 2009. And he's based in Karachi office. And he's Sarah, he's our program officer from 2526. And she's also based in the Karachi office. And she generally helps with me with the PDOs and program orientation and outreach and yeah. So that's the dynamic team, and you can see that 50% of this team is the alumni themselves. They're all highly, accomplished graduates from leading universities and institutions around Pakistan, and we are so privileged that they choose to work with us.
And now we have a short video that will give a great overview of the YES program in Pakistan.
Since 2003, over 1,000 Pakistani youth have participated in this program. We have had phenomenal experience interacting with communities in the United States, studying in high schools, participating in sports activities, cultural activities, community service activities.
Thing that these kids can do is to work hard, to keep an open mind, and to really just embrace the experience and stay positive. Thank you.
मैं मरियम सुलेमान ग्वादर से ग्वादर बलूचिस्तान का एक छोटा सा शहर
मेरा नाम हसीब अहमद है मैं पाकिस्तान से साहिवाल शहर से ताल्लुक रखता हूँ
मेरा नाम मुसाम मंजूर है और मैं पेशावर से हूँ
फुल नेम अभी फातिमा है और मैं इस्लामाबाद से आई हूँ
गिलगित बल्तिस्तान जो हम अपने इलाके का नाम बताते हैं उसके डिस्ट्रिक्ट गजर से ताल्लुक रखता हूँ
इस्लामाबाद से मैं हूँ मुझे हमेशा से यहाँ के पढ़ने का बहुत शौक था
When you take a person from Pakistan, Afghanistan, the first thing that comes to mind is terrorist, right? That's not true. I mean, I've learned it from him.
She doesn't do all those things that I was told by a lot of people, oh, you're going to bring teenage girls into your house and you can't leave them alone ever and they're going to do this and that. And that hasn't been my experience at all. I mean, both my girls are just great girls.
First day we came to the school, he'd go off to his class and I always stay behind, you know. All the girls are coming, who's that? Who's that? You know? I'd tell him, oh, he's pretty cute.
Having her in the class has been very inspirational for the other kids. I know that.
According to my scholarship program, I need to do 7 hours of community service and volunteering. I ended up with Grace Resource System, then I started serving there and to meet new people and like help them.
For over a decade, Yes Alumni Pakistan has become a very strong network of extremely dynamic and highly motivated individuals who are there on the ground creating an impact in the communities in terms of health and education and environment and whatnot.
Now, the best part about the Yes Alumni Network is that this group has grown from strength to strength every year in terms of helping community members and introducing unique active projects to help their community members in growing and elevating their lifestyles.
This is where when you see the power of Yes Alumni Pakistan making a difference.
This slide, basically this video kind of summarized our entire program from beginning to end. I would especially like to draw your attention to our marketing, promotion, and recruitment and preparing, process. So presently, I just came back yesterday from Islamabad after a week-long pre-departure institute with the 77 outbound students. And we also had a re-entry seminar where the Ambassador Hale awarded certificates to all the finalists for all the returning students. Next slide. So students who participate in the program. The program is open to all Pakistani students. Preference is given to the students who wouldn't otherwise afford a travel abroad program like that. That is underserved communities and girls. In Pakistan, the girls are not given a lot of opportunities, and this program we try to kind of get girls students apply, encourage them. Also, the students with physical disabilities, the program is open to all. The students are generally recruited from public schools, from trust schools, which are run by trust and donations, community schools. We don't kind of traditionally recruit students from elite schools unless those are the underserved students at our scholarship. The next slide. So major components of our selection program is marketing and promotion, compiling applicant pool. We basically send out a preliminary application that helps us, get a group of eligible applicants. And then those we have outreach and general test. It is a general English language test for, and in any average year, we receive more than 5,000 preliminary applications. And that is a huge number. So we kind of invite all the eligible applicant for our general English language test. And all those who pass this test are then invited to the second layer that is interviewing them. And after the at the interview, they bring the full 24-page application. And based on their interview, their test, and their completed application, a final selection is made. And the selection panel is formulated by the staff, one of my team member, and then people from the embassy and consulates and alumni. And all those semi-finalists are given the ELTIS test, and then they are finalized. So these are some of our marketing strategies. From last year, we have started a Facebook page, because that is, social media is a very quick and easy way to get to the applicants. So we have made up a social media page, and we engaged one of our person to kind of manage that social media page and answer the, we had social media live answering students' questions. We had Twitter campaign for answering prospective applicants' questions. We have help desk at the schools. We put booth in the local educational conferences. We send out flyers. There are advertisement on teen magazines, newspapers, newsletters of different schools. So there are all those different way of marketing and reaching out to the students. We generally have a 20 to 25 days window open where everybody applies, and all these marketing strategies happen, because fortunately or unfortunately, we have a very huge number of applicants. Some years they go as high as 8,000, which is like very difficult to process, but yeah. The next slide. So some of the challenges we face is the geographical, maintaining a geographical diversity. Like, if there are 100 students eligible from a school, we won't take all 100. And that means we may take one and make all the 90 unhappy. That is a big challenge, because we basically try to spread the scholarship as thinly geographically as possible. So, and girls from more religious and rural background, it is they don't have exposure. So oftentimes it is difficult to interview them, and they kind of don't appear very smart as other girls. But then we overcome this by actually letting more students apply, and the theory of numbers always work, because if you have a very, very large number of applications, then definitely there will be some definitely good. One of our priority on the program is to ensure the students are so well prepared that there are minimum possible issues at the USN. So our pre-departure orientations, since we take students from all different differing backgrounds, a lot of them are from rural areas. They haven't even traveled to cities ever, but those are smart girls and boys. So we have a very extensive pre-departure orientations and English language program. Right from, by January, we complete our recruitment and selection, and the students are finalized. So we start from February, we start the pre-departure orientation, which goes until July. The overall objective, you can see, it is to expose them to current global issues, study skills, life skills. We teach them research. We teach them reading and writing. Then there are personal grooming sessions, health hygiene, personal grooming, table manners. We have problem solving and coping with culture shock. And then Pakistani culture. Like every year, this year we gave them a book. We bought it for each student. It's on Pakistani culture and tradition. It's a very good book, which basically helps them presenting while they are in US. And then they leave that book in the school or with the host as souvenir. And there's a lot of emphasis on following rules and everything. So we have named from PDO, our June, we call it PDI, Pre-Departure Institute. So it has, there are three mode of delivering online. We have a very solid online, classrooms, which is on Ning, and on Facebook page for instructions, but there is a classroom on Ning. We have hired two Wylite students. Wylite, I think you all know that those are the students who are who got to graduate from the English language program in Washington, D.C. And I have designed, I personally designed an English language module, and which is delivered through the Ning. And then Facebook is mostly for instructions and communications. Then we have three different face-to-face orientations. One is the parents orientation. As soon as the students are selected in somewhere end of February or March, we invite all the parents, answer all their questions, tell them all the possible good things, bad things that could happen to them, so they are prepared and they don't freak out down the year. Then we have 2 days of students enhancement, that is downright English language workshop, which is basically expanded in the Ning class. This 2 days workshop helps them take the Ning class. We give them handheld devices, which are like not iPad, but they are handheld devices, which they take to all around wherever they are, and they are connected through this Ning and Facebook page and complete all the activities. Then we have summer PDI in Islamabad, which happened the last 5 days. And then I need, Gloria, this is hidden, the independent, how can I, okay, got it. So independent work is, they have to complete 20 hours of community service. There are books that are assigned to them to read. There are a couple of American history and geography books. There is 7 Habits of a Highly Effective Teenager. It's like a course book for PDI, and I personally teach that book. I've created a song as well for, and that song helps the student. They like that. It is a song on being proactive. And then there is English language classes that some of the students need additional English language classes beside Ning. So we arrange for them, but these are very few students, and some years they're not at all. And this independent work is what they do on Ning. So this is all about our PDI structure. The next. So here are some sample PDI activities I already explained to you. We don't need this slide. So early challenges with host families is food. You know, the first complaints I generally get is food. No matter how much we prepare, they are just teenagers. And they do whine for eating. They are still going through jet lag. It is totally a new environment. So sometimes I tell them, feed them French fries. They are very happy with that. But no, I know that won't be happening. So yeah, food is a challenge, and we basically prepare them. We try our best to prepare them for all kind of bland food. Unrealistic expectation by host family. These are some challenges. Like, you know, they're going to take us to places, and sometimes they expect them to buy them halal food. Let me tell you, we tell them very clearly that nobody's going to spend money on your halal food. Girls from village background are not accustomed to active lifestyle. It takes some time for them to be on their food and go and up and about. They are very slow in their movement. They are timid and shy. And then oftentimes there's communication gap, and this communication gap is because of cultural differences. In Pakistan, when you talk to a kid, a teenager, it is respectful for him or her to look down, not look into the eyes of the adults. When they go, and the same thing happens with an American host family, and he looks elsewhere or down, they think he's coward, which is not. He's looking down out of respect. So it is, I have prepared a handout on hosting Pakistani kids. I think, Gloria will give it all to you. It's good to go over it. It has some of these minute little things. You know, generally my experience working 16 years on this program is that it is the minor issues that makes the biggest, rift or misunderstanding between the host and the students. So let's focus on those. So sometimes more time for adjustment results in disappointment in both the sides, the parents and the students both. And impatience and generalization, like, you know, if a girl is shy, the host may think, oh, she's going to be like that forever. Give her some time. If the kids are looking down and not, waking up late, they are still going through jet lag and adjustment period. And the same is with the students. We keep telling them, that not to expect everything too fast. Right, the next slide. So insight into Pakistani culture, it's a part of Indian subcontinent colonized by British prior to 1947. So you will see there's a lot of British mannerism in our students, and they use British English and they're used to evening tea. Not that American families have to make it for them. Independent nation came in existence in 14 August. We have four provinces. Generally, an average Pakistani is not extremist, is not terrorist. They follow moderate Islamic practices. And it is run by a democratic government. The next slide. So our nation can be described by its hospitality. We are extremely hospitable, and one of the drawbacks of this hospitality is that a lot of negative elements crept up into our society in the name of hospitality, and they have created problems which gave us a bad name in the world, and it's not true. Our country is very beautiful. It has a whole range of ethnic diversity. The landscape is beautiful, and we are blessed with bounty of nature. And we enjoy a unique blend of traditionalism and modern world, both. It's a wonderful combination of this. We have celebrations which are, and in Pakistan, these, I wouldn't say celebrations, but there are two kind of holidays. There are sad holidays, and then there are happy ones. Generally around the world, there are happy holidays. But we have some sad holidays, which are basically the death of some Sufis, prophets, and like those. So maybe some of those days, students might feel like Ashura. So some of those students maybe may want to spend more time for prayers. And the happy ones are two Eids, you know, which is the end of the fast and the sacrificial holiday. So beliefs about rule of family. Pakistanis are generally very, very family oriented, and the role of family is the most important thing in their lives, most important than anything. I mean, it is the elders of the family who just makes decision. Until they die, they generally make decision for everyone else in the family. You can marry unless the parents are happy. You can make major decisions. This is generally, it's like that. And then food and eating are, you know, are a family affair like in any other American home. One meal of the day is being, you know, is taken together. And most of the time, the kitchen is a woman's job, not the man's job. But while at the PDO, we made it very clear. We have case studies. We have scenarios. Our students, boys, are ready to, you know, be a part of the household, and not be the man who just sits and have the woman wait on them. There is simply, where teenage are concerned, there is simply no concept of privacy or personal space. The parents can barge in their room, rummage through the personal belongings. It is less now than how it used to be 10 years back, but then generally, you know, our children are very happy living in huge big families and sharing rooms and stuff. The next slide. So this holidays, I already talked about it. So there's a whole list of holidays. I don't know what's coming up. So there are some greetings and manners, saying Assalamu Alaikum, which means God bless. Youngsters say Salam first. Elders generally put a palm over their heads of younger ones and bless them. And they do the same thing with the girls. Same sex handshaking and hugging is okay. But opposite sex handshaking and hugging is not a norm. So well, when they, you know, a host family receive one of my girls at the airport and she just backs off if the host dad or brother try to hug, it's not that she's impolite, it's just that it is not. It's a different thing that when they come back, everybody learns to hug. And yeah, that's okay then, and yeah. They are not laughing in a louder voice in the presence of elders, not looking into their eyes. These are all like, you know, the norms. Keeping the heads and eyes lowers in front of the elders. None of these things define that these are bad mannered kids. They are all good mannered kids, and that's why they're looking down. We train them to smile. We train them to not lower their heads. But yeah, there's some of these things they have learned. It's hard to, like it takes time for them to, you know, learn. So our culture is basically segregated in most of the, you know, gatherings. You will see all the girls will sit at one side, all the men will sit in even if they are very educated, they still are like that. Guests are welcome any time of the day, and they cannot go without having food. Guests are considered blessing of God, and they are very well taken care of and spoiled. So yes, our students need to be made clear right from the onset that, well, you are not a guest. So don't expect, just the second day of their arrival, they should be very much a part of the family, and they're not guests. It's impolite for guests to help themselves from the to eat food. So the students need to be reminded that you are a part of the family. You can go put together a meal for you, make the cereal and eat your, because sometimes my students, like, you know, they go hungry to school because they thought it's very impolite to put cereal or take the breakfast themselves. We have extended family systems, and family are very caring and provide economic support to each other. The decisions are made collectively, especially about the major decisions of life, mostly men dominated, who are the ones whose prime responsibility is family's well-being and financial support. Going against family is a major, major social offense, and every family or clan has their own rules and norms by which they go. Some are liberal, some are very traditional, and that is the mix of the students that go. So eating together at least one meal, meal times are social times, of course. This is something very common, like US. Meat from animals killed in a certain way as described in religion is called the halal meat. Now let me tell you one thing. Halal only applies to meat and the meat of cattle. It doesn't apply for the meat of fish or seafood. Eggs and beside meat of chicken or goat or lamb or cow, all other kind of meat is, or pork. Pork in any form is not allowed in our religion. So students will never eat pork. They shouldn't be even forced to eat pork, because that is a very tough thing, and it will damage the program if they are forced to eat that. And sometimes it happens. So food is generally very spicy and aromatic in our culture. People eat by hands and sometimes with cutlery. We taught our students how to use the cutlery and napkins and table manners. Fast food are very popular with these kids, like pizza and burgers and French fries. So in the first week, these can be the life-saving food. And a staple is eaten more in quantity. Like you'll see, they'll eat a lot of bread and a little bit of curry or a little bit of meat, or they'll eat a lot of rice. So staple is keeps them happy. The next. I think I did talk about that. So these are primarily the values that the students come with: religion, family, and then there is a pressure on them to keep up with the modern developments, yet follow the traditional rules. At times it creates a big confusion, and at times it's a big, pressure as well. I mean, even people like me who are middle-aged, who are educated, are still caught in this web of living in a modern age and yet holding on to tradition and cultural norms. And that's why some of the cultural norms we expect our students to continue holding while in US. For example, dating. For example, not wearing clothes which basically show a substantial part of their body, like backless spaghetti blouse, tops or mini dresses. They basically, sometimes the girls, they wear that, they put their picture, and they get in trouble back home. We don't want that. So my request from the host and the placement organization is to ensure that the girls don't do that, because they are young, they'll get carried away, but they shouldn't. So social conflict between primary and secondary groups, there is, this is a very long thing. Can we just leave that, the last point? It's a very complete theory of social. So students are generally, so now let's talk about a few things which basically make Pakistani students very, very hostable. They make excellent good host students with not a lot of baggage. They are very, very curious and enthusiastic about participating in this program and exploring the culture. They are very interested in learning lifestyles, and they look forward to the most exciting. This year is extremely valuable for them. They are really very proud of participating in the program. They go to all length to make it successful. Next comes the next. Can I have the next slide? So yeah. I want to go back. What was the first slide? Yeah, next slide, sorry, I didn't miss it. So generally an average Pakistani teenager lives a very quiet and protected life. They don't have a huge exposure beside their schools, their own family, and a few friends in the neighborhood where they live. So they generally get along, they are used to obeying their elders and saying yes to anything that their elders are saying, but that doesn't mean they are dumb. If those students are asked to babysit 10 children in a kindergarten and not do their homework, they know that they are being misused. Or if a girl is used as a maid in a house, she knows that that is not the right treatment she deserves. So they are generally very obedient, they obey very well, and they live with the extended host families. They avoid confronting or arguing with elders, and generally they'll appear very eager, enthusiastic, and ready to adapt and be friendly. And they are very good help around the house, but I suggest not to use them as maids or servants. Why I'm saying is that every year there is one odd case where they are mistook as babysitters or house help. The next slide. So over the years, Pakistani students exchange have a great record of a good academic performance. Generally, if you say there are 100 students or there are 107 students, their academic performance is generally, kept at a very, they maintain it. they found the US, the American, schools very easy. My one piece of advice is to discourage those students to take AP classes. They have studied maths and chemistry and physics of a very higher level here. So when they go back, their counselors, when they see that, they studied all that, they tend to give them AP classes. Those AP classes sometimes burden them so much that they keep studying and not participate in other activities. And we tell them that not to burden themselves with so much of hard, difficult academics that they don't find time in any other activities. So, but that the students are very good at other sports activities and curricular activities, and the host families are really proud to go and see them playing in the grounds or see them involved in all the exciting activities. They would be proud parents of for a year. The next slide. So our students come from a country which is rich in culture, tradition. They sing beautiful songs. They have cultural dances, and they can add to any community where they go. And share all these their handicrafts, their cultural dances, cultural songs, and outfit. So they'll be very a very colorful, lively addition in any community as a cultural ambassador. The next. English is the second official language in Pakistan, so generally the students doesn't have so much of communication problem. There may be some difference in the phrases that you use and how they use, but overall, as compared to a lot of exchange students, our students are good in English because it is the second official language, and we prepare them well in American English. And, and they study English as a language in the schools as well. So all Pakistani students upon their return to Pakistan work on projects for community. They are very actively involved. So if you are helping place one student, or if you are a host family, host one student, just remember that they are going to come back and impact a lot of communities. Like maybe hundreds to thousands of people are impacted by just one of those exchange students. And I also wanted to share one thing I think probably I missed at the back, is that Pakistani students are not at this age, they are not allowed dating. And so, the host families don't have to deal with all these dating issues, alcohol or smoking issues, because the students, they don't smoke, they don't date, or they are not involved in any of those activities. Okay, so glimpse of alumni programs, yeah.
Great, and here we have another fantastic video that the alumni in Pakistan created in celebration of the 15th anniversary of the YES program.
Far away from my home, and I made a new family with so many friends all around the world.
Hi, this is Abida Batul.
Hello, my name is Sarma Wahid.
I'm from the batch of YES 2005 to 2006.
I was placed in Los Angeles, California.
I belong to YES 2016 and 17.
Hi, my name is Mubashirani Fajra.
Hi, I'm Samir Azaf from YES 14.
And I was placed in Utica, Michigan.
And I went to US back in 2009-2010.
Hi, my name is Mohammed Swaha.
Hi, my name is Abdullah Nadeem. I was placed in Harrisonburg, Virginia.
Hi, my name is Suleiman Makani. I went to the United States in 2014.
YES improved my social skills and it made me a better listener.
And more than that, to be an extrovert and people-loving person.
YES has a huge part in my life. Ever since I became the part of this YES family, it has transformed me a lot.
YES taught me how to be flexible in tough situations and handle them with great responsibility.
YES helped me see the world through a different perspective. It taught me that true change begins with yourself.
It gives me a feeling to help others, to think about the people around me.
So the social skills I've gained, the leadership skills I've gained, and the independence and confidence that I got from the YES program has really helped my career.
YES pushes you, challenges you, and makes you even better. And more importantly, it helps to find the real you.
YES has impacted my life and the life of people around me. And I'm really thankful to YES for this.
YES took 15 years of sharing, caring, experiences, and adventures. Make this journey continue and bring us more talent and
youth
to be yours. Thank you, YES.
Happy YES 15th anniversary.
Thank you, YES, for giving the amazing 15 years to the world by having this exchange program, because this is the connection that we need for a better world.
Happy YES 15th anniversary.
And I want to thank the State Department for supporting us, helping us, and you know, bringing this opportunity.
And thank you, YES, for changing me into a better person.
I'm very proud to be a part of YES program. Thank you, YES, for changing my life and giving me a new outlook of life.
Happy 15th anniversary, YES.
Happy 15th anniversary, YES.
All right, I'll open the floor now for questions and comments.
Yeah, I love that video. It's always so great to hear from the alumni how they've changed and they're able to reflect on that. And maybe there are some POs in here who recognize those faces. We have a comment here. Sabrina's asking, can we share these videos? Yes, so both of the videos, the first one that we played and the one we just played now, are on YouTube. They're all on the YES program playlist on YouTube. And we are actually featuring every single one of our YES countries throughout this year. And each of the alumni associations have made very similar videos with alumni interviews. So we will go ahead and make sure to share some of those links with you as well. Great. And Farah, we actually, it seems like Sabrina was a host mom for one of our students.
Yeah, that's good.
Great. So if you want to go ahead and add any questions or share any commentary with us in the chat, we'd love to open the floor up for some discussion. And in the meantime, I will launch the second poll that we have asking, what is your biggest challenge when it comes to placing Pakistani students? Great, and we have some votes coming in. Oh, that's wonderful. And Sabrina has just said, you're right, Pakistani students are super social, lovely students, so very smart, and one of her favorite experiences. And you should all hear what the students have to say about the host families, because they are just so grateful and appreciative of all the host families and communities as well. Great. So the poll, I will share the results. And it looks like we have 69% of the PO representatives saying that dietary restrictions is the biggest challenge. And then we have 31% saying that it's often media portrayal. Farah, you want to share a little bit about that?
There are basically five things that every year categorically are the problems that Pakistani student gives. Definitely one is food, right? Despite that, we tell them everything. They are, they are communicated. They just go back and expect. So what I'd say is that nothing much can be done here but to repeatedly tell them this is what it is and you have to eat it or go hungry. I mean, and they come to me and then they said, okay, fine, there are other options. Sometimes the students don't know options. There are all kind of cheese there. There are eggs. There are, fish. They, they should try out new things.
Yeah, and I know you do a lot of training with them also to be prepared to be on a vegetarian diet, right? If that's easier, then they're all ready, to do that or stick to seafood.
Then is the problem, another problem that that everybody face is their over-communication. These kids are, smartphones are very cheap and the data packages are extremely cheap in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. So they are on WhatsApp, and in the last 3-4 years, the moms have the WhatsApp as well. So since moms started being on the WhatsApp, the students' life become literally miserable. They keep messaging, okay, what did you eat? Where are you sitting? Okay, you're watching TV. Where are you sitting? Where is your host family sitting? Okay, send me a selfie. Send me a picture. So we had a very, rigorous session this time as to how to deal with, less communication with moms. We did tell this to moms, but I know so well all of those moms are not going to listen to me. So I can control the students. So I control, I kind of taught them. But yes, they're over communication. Then they are all obsessed with graduation. It is given to them in written that in 10 months, you cannot get a high school diploma, but across Atlantic, they're all hard disk get reformatted. And they start kind of pestering the school, a counselor for, I want to get a diploma, otherwise I would fail in Pakistan and I'll have this. They come up with all kind of activities. So it's nothing will happen in Pakistan. They know very well, their school knows, their family knows and everything. They are just trying to be smart and taking a chance that they might talk the school into doing something. There's a little problem with Pakistani kids is that since they got selected for the YES program, they are just very fast. They manage to impress their their school or teachers. They think they can outsmart everyone and all time. And sometimes they are victim of their own smartness. So,
yeah, but we really appreciate that you. I know that you kind of drill this into them before they leave. They pretend to forget maybe a little bit, but you know, every time it is brought up, we appreciate the support that you do in reminding them if there's a counseling call that happens, or you also go ahead and remind the parents. So,
just tell them my name and they'll be fine. They'll remember everything. They remember. It's not that they forget anything. They remember everything. It's just, you know, the children, they have a hard time thinking that how come what I'm saying, the things that I've said, is, you know, their host parents know the same thing, or their school may know the same thing. They are the kind, okay, this is Seattle, or this is whatever. How would they know what Ms. Farah said to me?
Yeah.
So, yeah, like, you know, my name brings back all their memories and everything, and they'll be fine.
Yeah, so tip, I guess, to all of the peer representatives that are here, you just say, do you remember what Ms. Farah said? Maybe print out a picture of her face. And
they'll remember everything.
Yeah, and everything will be resolved. Great. It looks like there's a comment from Martha Mitchell asking, there was a point that Farah said she wanted to save for the end. Do you remember what that was? Do you want to cover it now?
Yeah, that was basically, I was talking about the primary and the secondary culture. Mm. See, in every society, the way the society is fabricated, there is a primary culture. In Pakistan, that is based in religion. That is embedded in family and norms. And then there are subcultures. And things vary, religious practices and values and beliefs vary in those subcultures. You will, having said the food problem, you will find many students who might eat Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Yep.
And they will say it's okay. Many a times what Imam Bashir says doesn't apply to some sects of Muslims in Pakistan. They won't say, no, we can't do that, even despite the fact that Imam said that. And so, you know, there may be a variation in the students. I cannot kind of generalize it. Two things. They are all individual human beings. They're all growing, and their thoughts and ideas are framing in a different way. And then they are, and secondly, they are, influenced by their individual family, individual beliefs. So it might vary from maybe one student to another. They adapt in a different way. So that is what I meant.
Yeah. And I think okay. This was covered with the Bangladesh group also. Mm-hmm. But yeah. Some of the students, you know, when they're in the country and they're filling out the application, they're going to be very strict and formal. And they're going to say, we cannot eat this. We must abide by this. But once they come to America, you're right. They are eating Kentucky Fried Chicken. They are eating McDonald's. So early on, there might be a little bit of that difficulty, but they do become more flexible.
So another thing the problem with our kids is, it's not a problem, but it's that they need to be told. There is a ablution before prayers, and they wet the bathrooms. Like in American homes, the bathrooms have floors that are covered with carpets and they're not wet. So somebody in the home need to tell them or find them a place where they can take ablution. It's not that he doesn't know how to use it. It's just that now he or she is not used to a carpeted bathroom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think a lot of these things are related to communication. Like you were saying, sometimes you just have to be very straight with the kids. We can't eat this, this food is available to you. Show them kind of around the room and just openly talking about these things.
And actually I give them, even in the pre-departure workbook, there are 2-3 pages of questions that the students are required to ask the family as soon as they arrive. Those are the questions I made like 10 years back. And I tell my students that as soon as they arrive and they get to sit with one of their host parents, they ask those questions. And those are very simple questions. What do I call you? What are my chores? Who I share the bathroom with? Is my towel different? Or can you give me another towel? Do I buy my own toothpaste and toiletry? That kind of very little questions. And most of my students say that basically helps them break the ice. And, I don't know if any of the area representative here have this experience of having my student ask questions from the host parents. Sabrina may say that, but that generally they are required to ask them. And I make sure that After the DCO arrival orientation, I send them a Facebook notification that they all remember asking those questions. Those are like 30 questions.
Yeah, it's a great homework assignment. I've seen it as well. So, you know, they just sit down with their host family and say, yeah, Martha is saying that's a great idea. It is. It's a fun icebreaker to have the students interview the host family and be like, you know, where should I put my laundry? Or what do you expect from me? And just being really clear about some things that could easily be miscommunicated. Yeah, does anyone else have any questions they'd like to ask Farah or some things that they'd like to share? Oh. So Sabrina is saying, honestly, I don't remember if he asked me those questions, but Sarosh called me mom from day one and that was the best thing ever. We also have Molly, who's sharing, I love the Pakistani students. I thought I saw Ahmad Farooqi in the last frame. He was one of mine a couple years ago. And thank you so much for all that you do. Oh, that's great. Thank you so much. Yeah. Have there been any strategies or resources that you have all found helpful in placing the Pakistani students and addressing some of those concerns, whether they be related to dietary restrictions or media portrayal in particular? Farah, do you want to talk a little bit about maybe the Pakistani students and how comfortable they are with pets or how you address that topic with them?
Generally, it varies from year to year, and we don't give them an option that they don't have. Listen, there are a few things that are simply not an option for Pakistani kids. Mm-hmm. Living with pets, and we give them the list of pets that has iguana, that have snakes, that has dogs and cats. And we actually show them pictures of students with all these animals as pets, and we prepare them. If they say that no matter what, we can live with pets, you can participate in the program then. You need to be very, because we have such a huge applicant pool, we select students who are ready to take challenges. So there are many kids who, don't like pets, but once they go and they see all those adorable cats, dogs, or lizard, or whoever those are, they just start liking them. So it used to be a problem in the first, several years of our program, but it's not a problem for the past, I think, a decade or so. That problem is solved, yeah. We don't give them an option of, if the host family can provide halal food, they are not supposed to demand halal food, period. So you don't even have to, we select them, we tell them, I've told their parents categorically, very firmly, that this is one thing I don't want to hear, that my kid is not getting halal meat. And we never had a year when a child is starved or came back malnutrition.
That is a guarantee. A little bigger.
Yeah, everybody, they become taller, they become broader. So yeah, they are eating well. So there's no point freaking about food. There's no point freaking about pet animals. No option.
Great. Yep. With all these thousands of applicants in Pakistan, I know you are picking the most open-minded and most flexible students that are ready for the program year. Great.
Yeah, one thing that happens is many a times students, they say for the sake of being selected, and when they go, oh my God, that big hound there with a pink, hanging a tongue, it scares them. It scares me as well. I don't have pets at home. So we basically train them in when they are in pre-departure orientation, we train them how to deal, work with them. Because they go in a house and they see the dog and they just get scared or back off and the dog thinks that he's playing and there's a chase begins, breaking furniture and things. So it's basically host parents need to teach them how to, interact with the pet.
Yeah, and now actually, Farah, when they come to DC, they get a little bit of a practice session. People bring their pets, and the kids get a chance to hang out with them. So, great. Well, it doesn't look like there are any more questions. Sabrina also said, thank you. No resources, but this is amazing to help us understand and do better. We hope that this provided a little bit of insight and that it is helpful for you all as you do all of the incredible work to place the students and support them throughout the year. Yeah, Farah, do you have any final comments before we start wrapping up?
Not exactly, but just one. My final one thing is that there are, especially where girls are concerned, and you know, the social media have made girls and women all the more vulnerable in Pakistan. So I wouldn't deal this problem a decade back, but after Facebook and Instagram and every Snapchat, girls have become vulnerable. So many a time the girls, you know, put up their pictures and they go to prom or they are into wearing clothes which are not a norm in Pakistan. They get in trouble when they are in Pakistan, when they come back. So I my request is to ensure that, because I very well remember several years back, there was a girl from a village who got a liking for miniskirt, and her host mom never allowed her. She cried and she threw tantrum that I wanted to wear it, and she said, no, it won't be acceptable in your village, so you're not going to wear that.
Yeah.
Despite the fact that her own daughter would wear it, and she said, no. And that is the way they, because, you know, wanted to wear all that, to put it up on their Facebook pages. There is a girl who's grounded this year. She returned back 2 weeks back, and just as soon as she's back, parents have totally grounded her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it's hard for the students to, you know, as they're adjusting to these new norms, to think about how culturally there might be some repercussions when they go back home into making, you know, certain photos public. So I think it is important for us, as I know you do already.
Yeah, and the social media now, things travel extremely fast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's something important to remember. And yeah, social media is always a big concern, I think, for all of us. Yeah, great. Well, I just wanted to remind everyone again that we do have a lot of great content on Pakistani students and alumni on the YES website. We have so many Pakistan stories. If you follow the YES program, we have lots of resources, including videos and photos that you can use, as well as if you follow our hashtags. I think Farah is going to put some links in the chat. And we have one final question that just came in. Farah from Brickenna, saying, what if the student wears a hijab, yep, and once arrives here in the U.S., decides not to wear it anymore? What should we do? And Farah said, not wearing hijab is fine. That is, do you want to make a comment about that? Yeah. Yeah, there are certain situations where that does happen. I think Farah's typing away. She's saying the bigger problem is photography generally with female students in intimate poses with boys. You know, as she discussed earlier on, there is certain expectations about opposite genders and how they interact. And sometimes when that is photographed and put publicly on Facebook, there are cases where it can be controversial. Farah also added, and clothing that shows substantial part of their bodies, like mini skirts, shorts, strapless, backless. Yeah. Great. I hope that's helpful to know. Great. Well, if there are no other questions or comments, we just want to thank you all again for making the time to attend this webinar. Thank you so much for everything that you do for this, for so many years, for this wonderful group. Thank you, Farah, for such an incredible, insightful presentation and all of your hard work as well.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks for joining.
I hope you all have a wonderful day.